Hi everyone, in this video we are going to see about Carnibacterium diphtheriae. First, we will see the general characteristics of Carnibacterium. It is a gram-positive, non-capsulator, non-sporing, irregularly stained and show club-shaped swelling. Now we are going to see about the Carnibacterium diphtheriae, morphology and identification of the Carnibacterium diphtheriae. It is pathogenic and most important species. It is gram positive, irregularly stained, club shaped, pleomorphic rod, non motile, non sporing, non capsulated. They are aerobes and facultative anaerobes. It shows Chinese letter or cuneiform arrangement pattern, which is most important due to incomplete binary fission. Once again, we are going to see about the morphology. They are most important and pathogenic species. They are gram positive, irregularly stained, club shaped, pleomorphic rod, non motile, non sporing, non capsulator, aerobes and facultative anaerobes. They live in both oxygen and without oxygen. It shows Chinese letter and cuneiform arrangement due to incomplete binary fission. They contain metachromatic granules at the pole of the bacilli, and the metachronic chromatic granules is otherwise known as polar bodies, Babesonner's granules, Wollaton granules. Their cytoplasmic granules are composed of polymetaphosphate. Acts as energy store of the bacteria. This polymetaphosphate acts as energy store of the bacteria. They are strongly gram positive. Epidemiology: transmission by aerosol and infected in skin lesion. Reservoir: human is the only reservoir for this Carnibacterium diphtheriae. Nasal carrier and throat carrier are a source of infection. The source of infection is due to the nasal carrier and throat carrier. Transmission by aerosol. It is transmitted by air. Reservoir by human and human only. There is only reservoir known as which is human. Pathogenicity and pathogenesis. Diseases are caused due to virulence factor for any organism. Here the virulence factor is diphtheria toxin. Primary virulence factor. Toxin has two fragments. This diphtheria toxin has two fragments. One A and another one is B. A for active and B for binding. The fragment A enters the cell, inhibit the EF2, and EF2 is responsible for protein synthesis and which inhibit protein. This happens only when fragment B binds to the host cell and helps in the entry of the fragment A. The fragment B only job is to make the fragment A to enter into the host cell. The fragment B bind to the host cell helps in the entry of fragment A. The fragment A enters the cell, inhibit EF2 is responsible for protein synthesis, so the protein synthesis is inhibited. The receptor of diphtheria toxin is HBEGF precursor, heparin biting epidermal growth factor. All cells are susceptible to the action of diphtheria toxin except RBCs. This is the most important point, all cells are susceptible to diphtheria toxin except RBC. The diphtheria toxin have more affinity to myocardium, adrenal and nerve endings. We can study this with a simple mnemonic: MAN, M-A-N, myocardium, M, A for adrenal, N for nerve ending. This diphtheria toxin has more affinity towards this MAN, which is myocardial, adrenal and nerve ending. Diphtheria toxin is coded for bacteriophage, beta carniophage, higher level of iron inhibit toxin synthesis. More amount of iron which inhibit toxin synthesis. The diphtheria toxin is antigenic, so antitoxins are protective in nature. The toxin are converted into toxoid for vaccination. The toxoid formation promoted by formalin, pH and acidic. These three promote the formation of toxin into toxoid. This toxoid is useful for vaccination. Clinical manifestation. There are two types of diphtheria according to the clinical manifestation: respiratory diphtheria and cutaneous diphtheria. Respiratory diphtheria, most common form. Tonsils and pharynx are most common site for the affection. Incubation is 3 to 4 days. When it is affected, the pharynx is also known as, mostly it affects pharynx and tonsils. When the pharynx is affected, is known as facial diphtheria. The facial diphtheria, when the diphtheria enter the body and elicit the inflammatory response that leads to necrosis of the epithelium and exudate formation. Always the diphtheria's main feature is the formation of pseudomembrane coat. When it enter into the body, it elicit an inflammatory response that leads to necrosis of epithelium and exudate formation. The formation of mucosal ulcer lined by tough, leathery, grayish-white pseudomembrane coat. The pseudomembrane coat is formed here. This indicates the man who is affected by diphtheria. The composed of inner band fibrin surrounded by this pseudomembrane coat is composed of inner band fibrin surrounded by neutrophil, RBC and bacteria. Severe cases, it may extend to larynx and bronchial airway, which the obstruction occurs and leads to fatal. The bull neck appearance is due to tonsillar swelling. It is the most important significance where the bull neck appearance due to tonsillar swelling. The neck oedema will be foul breath and thick speech. If untreated, death for 30%. There is a chance of death for 30%. The neck is oedema. In the tonsillar swelling, the neck oedema is seen, foul breath and thick speech. Here the cutaneous diphtheria is another one. Punched out ulcerative lesion, which the necrosis are rarely pseudomembrane formation. Here there are punched out ulcerative lesions with necrosis are seen, rarely pseudomembrane formation. Here rarely pseudomembrane formation takes place. This is not affected by toxin. It is due to the organism itself. It is not affected. It is not toxic mediator. It is due to the organism itself. Complication of diphtheria. Myocarditis. It is the most important one. Neurological problems due to demyelination. Slow and complete spontaneous recovery of neurological complication. Pneumonia, otitis media, renal failure. Thank you. This is the first part of the video. In the next part of the video, you will see about the lab diagnosis, prophylaxis and treatment. Thank you.